Nearly 100 years ago, we started telling ourselves a particular story about the beginning of everything. And it's a story that starts with a hot, unthinkably dense ball of matter and ends with right now. You probably know it best as the Big Bang Theory. And while different scientists may play around with slightly different versions of it, it does a pretty solid job explaining all the stuff that we see in the universe today. But there's a lot of stuff we don't see too. Like, after the Big Bang Theory first came about, our picture of the universe expanded to include a strange substance called dark matter, whose presence we can detect, but not the stuff itself. And so far, this mysterious form of matter has just been folded into the Big Bang. Most theoretical astrophysicists have carried on assuming that everything popped into existence during that one moment. But what if the story we've told ourselves for generations about how stars and planets and galaxies came to be isn't true for their dark matter cousins? Recently, some scientists have proposed that the Big Bang was followed by a dark Big Bang, which not only spawned all the matter belonging to this dark sector of reality, but spawned more matter than was made in the original. And if they're right, studying the universe's second, bigger bang could help us solve the mystery of what dark matter even is. Now, before we can talk about the dark Big Bang, we need to talk about the original Big Bang. In 1931, a Belgian scientist slash priest named Georges Lemaître made a simple conclusion. Because humanity had recently discovered that the universe was expanding, as opposed to just always being there, and all he needed to do was hit rewind. The universe got smaller and smaller until he hit the beginning of time. So Lemaître proposed a primeval atom, a super dense point that had the whole universe packed inside. And some version of that has been our universe origin story ever since. In the early days, scientists hypothesized that the universe's energy started off packed inside a singularity, an infinitely dense, hot point. And in this version of the story, the Big Bang was the moment when that singularity exploded to create the universe. That story explained the expanding universe pretty well overall, but it came with some thorny problems. Like the fact that the very concept of an infinitely dense point just doesn't exist physically. And if you take our best models of the universe and try to rewind the clock all the way to zero, the whole thing breaks before it gets there. The laws of physics spit out nonsense. So the modern concept of the Big Bang is a little different. It puts the Big Bang after a brief period in the universe's ancient history called inflation. In this version of the story, there was a sliver of a second at the beginning of time when the universe expanded exponentially in size, and it did so faster than the speed of light. No one knows what triggered this inflation or what came before it, but within less than a billionth of a billionth of a trillionth of a second, it was over. And it was only then that all the energy driving this breakneck expansion turned into matter and light, giving way to the Big Bang, and giving rise to all the stuff that's out there today. The thing is, the picture gets a little fuzzy when we try to extend it to the stuff that we can't see, which makes up a big piece of the pie. For example, for every gram of regular, visible matter, cosmologists believe that there are around 5 grams of so-called dark matter, an invisible substance that, at least as far as we know, only interacts with objects through gravity. We can watch it make stars at the edges of galaxies rotate faster than they would otherwise, and we can see how it warps space-time, bending light that passes by it. But we've never detected it directly. So even though it's been taunting astronomers for nearly 100 years, no one knows what dark matter is. We interrupt this video to bring you news about an interactive online learning platform with thousands of lessons in science, computer science, and math. It's brilliant. And the news is they just launched a ton of new data content that uses real-world data to find trends and make better informed decisions. It's so new that they let you learn with data from X, not Twitter. And while you're learning about what real-world data can tell you, you're also learning how to learn from data. I mean, that's what the lessons are actually about. But Brilliant gives you a reason to learn multiple linear regression that isn't related to what's on your big test next week. While you're solving problems that are relevant to your life, Brilliant is teaching you all kinds of statistics, probability, and modeling without asking you to just memorize the stuff. Their case studies and puzzles keep you engaged in what you're learning. And you can find all of that new data content at brilliant.org/scishow or the link in the description down below. That link will also give you 20% off an annual premium Brilliant subscription, and you'll get your first 30 days for free. Thank you to Brilliant for supporting this SciShow video, and let's get back to it. It's part of what astronomers call the dark sector, the part of the universe that's made up of mysterious substances that we've never explored directly, yet is most of reality as we know it. The dark sector makes up around 95% of the universe, but all we know about it is how it pushes and pulls on the rest of the universe, the part that's made up of regular matter and energy and light. So the idea that everything in the dark sector was born during the Big Bang is as good a guess as any, but it's still just a guess. There's no actual reason why it has to be that way. We can't observe the moments immediately after the Big Bang because it was so hot and dense that space was completely opaque. Light couldn't shine through the universe, so we don't even know for sure what regular matter was doing, let alone if dark matter was there interacting with it. And considering that regular and dark matter barely interact with each other anyway, some scientists are considering whether dark matter could have emerged at a later time, in what they call the dark Big Bang. It's all hypothetical at this point, but as long as they've got this idea on the table, their task is to figure out how a dark Big Bang might have gone down if it did happen. It's kind of like your lunch is missing and you're trying to figure out if your dog ate it. To solve the mystery, you might start by imagining the potential clues that you could look for. For example, you know your dog is a messy eater, so if it really did eat your BLT, it probably left some crumbs behind. Plus, it's not supposed to eat human food, so it might get an upset stomach. Or at the very least, it might not be as hungry when dinner time rolls around. And astronomers are taking the same general approach here. They're trying to paint a picture of the hypothetical dark Big Bang so that observers can look for any crumbs that suggest it really happened. And one crucial detail is when it happened. Hypothetically, anyway. Cosmologists know that dark matter played a big role in seeding the large-scale structure of the universe today. It helped draw regular matter into the massive web of galaxy clusters that stretches as far as we can see. So it had to have been around early enough to play that role and fit into our models of how that structure evolved. And according to computer models, a dark Big Bang most likely took place a mere month after the regular one. But a question that's far more important than the when is the what. What, if anything, actually happened? The team proposing this dark hypothesis suggests that prior to this second bang, there was a dark matter vacuum. Now, a vacuum is what we think of as pure emptiness. So in this dark matter vacuum, there would have been some regular matter, but it would have been empty of dark matter. But according to quantum mechanics, nothing is truly empty. Even so-called empty space is frothing with particles that spontaneously and incredibly briefly pop in and out of existence. So a vacuum still has at least some amount of energy in it. But that at least is important, because a vacuum can have different energy states. While it likes to be in the lowest energy state possible, better known as a true vacuum, it doesn't have to be. And scientists refer to that situation as a false vacuum. You can think of a false vacuum like a pothole on an inclined street. If a ball gets stuck in the pothole, whether it got kicked up the hill or was rolling down the hill, it can stay stuck for a long time. But as soon as a car or a gust of wind nudges the ball out of the pothole, it will roll down the street and wind up resting at wherever the bottom of the hill is, because the bottom of the hill is at a lower energy state than the pothole. Now, the energy state of a vacuum is a little harder to picture, but the basic concept is the same. A false vacuum may be stable for a really long time, but it can suddenly drop to a lower energy state. And this is called a phase transition. On Earth, we're familiar with certain types of phase transitions that happen in chemistry, like when liquid water vaporizes into a gas or freezes into a solid. And cosmological phase transitions aren't completely dissimilar. They're also sudden changes in the form and properties of matter. Some theorists hypothesize that during the original Big Bang, a phase transition transformed a false vacuum into a smattering of particles, not unlike how a gas condenses into a liquid. And in this hypothetical dark Big Bang, something similar may have happened too. Just like a pot of water that's beginning to boil, a false vacuum on the verge of a phase change begins to bubble. And yes, the cosmologists actually refer to them as bubbles. They're little spots where the vacuum starts dropping to a lower energy state. And as they expand at near light speed and bump into each other, these bubbles collapse the false vacuum into a true vacuum. Now, in the case of the hypothetical dark matter vacuum, the energy from these expanding bubbles gets released as dark matter and dark radiation, much like the matter and light released in the collapse of the vacuum that created the Big Bang. But exactly what comes out of this dark phase transition depends on how it plays out. In one hypothetical scenario, bubbles could slam together fast enough that their energy can turn directly into humongous dark matter particles that are up to 10 trillion times the mass of a proton. The authors of this dark Big Bang hypothesis have affectionately dubbed them Darkzillas. But if the phase transition plays out more slowly, the colliding bubbles will first create a hot plasma in the dark sector. And while the plasma is hot, small dark matter particles will emerge from interactions within it. It's this kind of transition that could create the most popular candidates for dark matter particles out there today. They're known as WIMPs, or weakly interacting massive particles, and scientists are actively searching for them with a bunch of different experiments around the world. Eventually, the plasma cools, slowing down the interactions taking place within the plasma and ending the creation of more dark matter. But that's just two scenarios of many, and right now theorists aren't sure which, if any, might be right. But they hope they'll find evidence that points them in the right direction. Because remember, even though this is all hypothetical and it all happened at a time we can't observe directly, it's like the dog that ate your sandwich when you weren't looking. The dark Big Bang would have left behind some crumbs. And while those bubbles that carry out the phase transition between a false vacuum and a real vacuum are invisible, they would have generated gravitational waves as they collided. Gravitational waves are ripples that warp space-time as they pass through it, subtly pinching and stretching the distances between objects. And thanks to advancements in technology, scientists are getting better and better at detecting tinier and tinier signals. Like in 2023, a massive international collaboration called NanoGrav announced that they had successfully detected a sort of gravitational wave background noise coming from all around us. Buried within that signal would be gravitational waves created during the Big Bang. And eventually, more detailed studies will help scientists tease apart exactly what made them. And maybe one day they'll reveal that there really was a second Big Bang. Or maybe they won't. Cosmologists don't need a dark Big Bang to explain how we got a universe full of dark matter. And there are plenty of alternate proposals that I don't have time to dive into here, like primordial black holes or a kind of ultra-dense matter called quark nuggets. But I'm pulling for you, dark Big Bang, if only to read all the fun sequel names that people put in the comments.